Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
We have come rejoicing in the house of the Lord with this celebration, dear brothers and sisters. And now we stand with Thomas and Grace on the day they intend to form a home of their own. For them, this is a moment of unique importance. So let us support them with our affection, with our friendship, and with our prayer as their brothers and sisters. Let us listen attentively with them to the word that God speaks to us today. Then, with Holy Church, let us humbly pray to God our Father through Christ our Lord. For this couple to serve us, that he lovingly accept them, bless them, and make them always one.
Christ is her chaste soul. A holy and decent woman adds grace and Let your life be free from love of money, but be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never forsake you or abandon you. Thus, you may say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, and I will not be afraid. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Because each one of you have built yourself individually now that you come together in the sacrament of holy matrimony, you bring those foundations together. Now this is important because as you go through your married life together, build on that solid foundation upon which you build your home as husband and wife. You have to realize that that foundation of your home helps, like we read a couple Sundays ago, that salt and that light in the world to go forward and be the leaven in society. The society is built upon the strength and the foundation of the family. So if the family foundation, your home, is not strong, you are not contributing to that greater good that we all look for and hope for. So a couple thoughts going in. We've talked about permanence, right? We've talked about fidelity. We've talked about hope is alive. I'm not worried about those issues and or concepts with you. But I do want to talk to you about a little bit today is the concept of humility in your marriage. Now, humility is an often misunderstood virtue in the sense that people think that we should think less of ourselves. Being humble, oh, I'm not that good at this, I'm not that good at that. That's false humility. But if you're good at something, you're proud of the fact that you're good at it. God gave you that talent and that ability to serve one and to serve the other. Humility is thinking less, thinking of yourself less. So think of yourself less often. And so there's kind of a hierarchy of humility that we have to look at in your married relationship, okay? And remember, we talked about this, is putting the needs of the other before your own needs. That's foundational to being a Christian, not just to the married life and the success of the marriage, but particularly in marriage, putting the needs of the other before your own needs. It's absolutely imperative. So we look at God is first on that hierarchy of humility. You know, all praise, all glory, all honor to Him. And realize that He plays an active role beginning today with the sacrament of matrimony, which you enter, giving you the grace you need to be the man, woman, husband, wife, mother, father that you were created to become. That begins today. Next on that hierarchy, next on that rung, the next one down is your spouse. It's not you. Everything that you do should be ordered to God through her. Ordered to God through Him. And then once the kids start coming along, God willing, you keep walking down the lower rung, down that ladder. Because their needs are always superior to your needs. And this can be difficult at times. We must be honest about that. But you'll come to learn that the love that you feel in a very emotional, a very physical and a very real way today will be purified ultimately by the love of sacrifice. Of sacrificing yourselves, one for the other, for your family, for your children. The example of which is set we see today. The contest of your marriage will take place within the holy sacrifice of the Mass, where God, Jesus, shows us perfect love. And that's the love He wants you to emulate. So as we go forward, we're about to pronounce your marriage vow. I want you to remember that. Humility, thinking of yourself less, not thinking less of yourself. Each one of them, beautiful, perfect, dignified creation of God, but thinking of yourself less.
Dearly beloved, you have come together into the house of the church so that in the presence of the church to minister in the community, your intention to enter into marriage may be strengthened by the Lord with a sacred seal. Christ abundantly blesses the love that binds you. Through special sacrament, He enriches and strengthens those He has already consecrated in holy baptism, that they may be faithful to each other forever, assume all responsibility in married life. And so, in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. Thomas and Grace, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly? Are you prepared, as you follow the path of marriage, to honor and to love each other for as long as you both shall live? Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church. Since it is your intention to enter into the covenant of holy matrimony, I ask you to please join your right hand and declare your consent before God and his church. I, Thomas, take you, Grace, to be my wife. I promise to be faithful to you.
I promise to be faithful to you.
In good times and in bad.
In good times and in bad.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love you and to honor you.
To love you and to honor you.
All the days of my life.
All the days of my life.
I, Grace, take you, Thomas, to be my husband. I promise to be faithful to you. In good times and in bad. In sickness and in health. To love you and to honor you. All the days of my life. May the Lord, in his kindness, strengthen the consent you have declared before the church, and graciously bring to fulfillment of his blessing within you. What God joins asunder, let no one put asunder. May the Lord bless these rings, which you will give to each other as a sign of love and fidelity. Receive this ring.
Receive this ring.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy Spirit.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Thomas. Receive this ring. As a sign of my love and fidelity. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Life. We pray.
of the sacred bond of marriage. And just as your goodness is its origin, may you provide guidance for us through Christ our Lord.
Their homage to you, the
bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. We praise you for all these offerings, the serene and kind of countenance, and to accept them as much as we please to accept the gifts of your Son, and the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our Father, and the offering of our priesthood. God, who by your mighty power created all things out of nothing, and when you had set in place the beginnings of the universe, formed man and woman in your own image, making the woman an inseparable helpmate to the man, that they might no longer be two, but one flesh, and taught that what you were pleased to make one must never be divided. O God, who consecrated the bond of marriage by so great a mystery, that in the wedding covenant you foreshadowed the sacrament of Christ and his church. O God, by whom woman is joined to man in the companionship they had in the beginning is endowed with the one blessing not forfeited by original sin, nor washed away by the flood. Look now with favor on these your servants, joined together in marriage, who ask to be strengthened by your blessing. Send down on them the grace of the Holy Spirit, and pour your love into their hearts, that they may remain faithful in the marriage covenant. May the grace of love and peace abide in your daughter Grace, and let her always follow the example of those holy women whose praises are sung in the scriptures. May her husband entrust his heart to her, so that acknowledging her as his equal and his joint heir to the life of grace, he may show her due honor and cherish her always with the love that Christ has for his church. And now, Lord, we implore you, may these your servants hold fast to the faith and keep your commandments. Made one in the flesh, may they be blameless in all they do. And with the strength that comes from the gospel, may they bear true witness to Christ before all. May they be blessed with children and prove themselves virtuous parents who live to see their children's children. And grant that reaching at last together the fullness of years for which they hope,
they may come the life of the blessed in the kingdom of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have one announcement, and that is immediately following the recessional, everyone's going to come back up here at the bridal party and take pictures right away. And then after that, they'll be receiving wine in the vestibule if you'd like to meet the couple. And after that, the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Before the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
It was my honor to introduce to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Adams.
Thank you. One, Try to do what?
Grace's father to join her on the dance floor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Grandpa Chris.
They will be dancing to Life is Beautiful by The Afters.
Through the window, I see you waiting. You're smiling, 'cause I'm coming. Your eyes are a story, an ocean of memories, pictures of faces and places, and all of the things that make us feel like we have it all. All of the times that make us realize we have it all. We have it all. Life is New Year's dreams, a toast with friends, a soldier coming home from war, a faith, a hope, for so much more.
Because we're going to call up all mothers and sons to the dance floor to join them.
You know there's a light that goes by the front door. Don't forget the keys under the mat. When childhood stars shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church cause your mama says to. Visit grandpa every chance that you can. It won't be wasted time. Always stay humble and kind.
Can we have all mothers and sons join them on the dance floor, please? If you have your mothers and childs here, could you join them on the dance floor?
Always keeps you from flying. Always stay humble and kind. Know the difference between sleeping with someone and sleeping with someone you love. I love you. Always stay humble and kind. Oh, the door said please, said thank you. Don't steal, no cheat, no lie. I know you got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. Those dreams. summer sunshine. Always stay humble and kind. Don't take for granted the love this life gives you. When you get where you're going, don't forget, turn back around. Help the next one in line. Always stay humble and kind.
How about a big round of applause for everybody, ladies and gentlemen? All right, this time we're going to have a couple of toasts given by our best man and maid of honor today. Where's Isaac and Jane?
If there's room. Forgive me for reading off the paper. I didn't have time to memorize it. And I am a little nervous, so.
That's all right, Jane.
So, I've been planning this speech for Grace's wedding since I was probably 10. I'm not being overdramatic or, like, exaggerating that at all. Like, I was a little girl, like, not planning my speech for an award show. I was planning my speech for Grace's wedding, always. In my head, something funny would happen. I'm like, I have to mention that at her wedding. Yes. And that's probably because Grace and I, obviously, are sisters. But she's also been my best friend for most of my life.
You're my favorite lady.
Only little sister.
Only little sister.
I say most because there was a couple of years there when I was like 11 to 13 when we shared a room. And she would yell at me every single time I left my clothes on the floor. That's probably because she almost died a couple times by slipping on them. But for the longest time, I ignored that fact. I'm admitting it now. And like, even a little over a year ago, before Grace had even met Tommy, I was still planning my speech at her wedding. Like, I was still doing this. And at that time I thought, yeah, I've got so much time to write the greatest speech ever. It's no big deal. So you can imagine my surprise when Tommy and Grace met and just automatically hit it off and just fell in love. And 4 months later they were engaged. You know, Tommy and I were in our driveway crying as he showed me the ring he was going to propose to my sister with, like, 4 months after they met. So when that happened, I was like, well, I have a lot less time to plan a speech. And then when the wedding got moved up, I had even less time. So literally the day I got the phone call that the wedding was going to be on Valentine's Day, pulled out my notebook and I wrote this speech. And then I just finally typed it up and made it official at the end of the day. So, and writing the speech was always like an easy thing for me to think about doing because I was going to be writing about my best friend, you know. And then when I met Tommy, it became an even easier thing because I wasn't only writing the speech for my best friend, I was writing a speech for my new brother and one of the greatest people I've ever met. So it became 10 times easier to rip this baby out. Also, pretty easy to write a speech when you're writing a speech about a couple who's like right out of a romantic comedy. You know how it goes. Boy meets girl, automatically falls in love with her beauty, sees her again at a party, and then they're just in love. And then 4 months later, they're engaged. And then here we are at their wedding as the maid of honor gives a speech that everyone just cries at. You know. But if this were an actual romantic comedy, I would be laughing at it the entire time. Grace knows I make fun of romantic comedies. I would just be saying, you know, that happens so unrealistically fast. No one meets and falls in love that quickly. You know, the marriage is gonna fail. Like, it's just not real love. It's not gonna happen. I just cursed your marriage. Sorry. And but being as close to you you guys as I am, spending as much time with you guys. Like, I was seeing this real, genuine, pure love happen before my very eyes every single day. And every single day, I became a little bit more one of those people that likes to watch romantic comedies. So, I mean, even after 19 years of watching TV and love on romance, like, within a year, Tommy and Grace had taught me more about what true love was, and what it meant, and how it felt, and just how it should be in a year. You probably still won't want to watch a romantic comedy with me, though, because Tommy and Grace taught me what real love is. Not TV love, not acting. This is real, genuine. You know, what you're seeing before you is the real, genuine thing. Like, and it's really cool because now I get to look at the other couples around me, my parents and all my siblings and everyone around me, and I get to see them, and I see them in a different way. I see it in a genuine way. I have a better understanding, a better appreciation for just how incredible it all is. So, I want to say thank you to you guys for opening my eyes to what real love is, not TV love, but to making me a little less of a love grump. So, thanks for getting white girl wasted one night and falling in love the next. Here's to the bride and groom. Woo!
I would like to start off congratulating Tommy and Grace on their beautiful wedding. First of all, good evening, everyone. For those who don't know me, Isaac Yergi. Me and Tommy have been friends since we were little. I would like to start off by thanking all those who made it out to celebrate this with them. It was a very special night. I also would like to thank Tommy for not making all the groomsmen wear camouflage suits and redskin hats. I'm very honored to be standing here tonight as the best man. You've had such a positive impact in my life growing up. In so many ways, I can't put it into words. You have been there for me through my highs and lows. In my life. And couldn't be more proud and honored to call you my friend and brother. I know now for sure that Tommy found the true love, because once he met Grace, I never saw him again. I like to tell a short story, though, a good memory, which is kind of good and bad. But when me and Tommy went hiking on an old rag for my birthday, we made it to the top safely, and then on our way down, we decided to run. And knowing Tommy, injury prone, he sprained his ankle really bad, and we weren't sure what to do. It was getting late and dark. And I was like, you know, praying. I was like, okay, God, we need help. You know, this is going to, we were like 3 miles, I think, 2.5 miles from the car. Yeah, 4 miles, very far from the car. And so I started praying, and before I know, we see these two young people, this really big, jacked guy with long blonde hair, looked like a freaking angel. And I'm not even kidding. Comes over, he's like, you guys all right? I'm like, you know, looking like, this guy is now sure is just jacked. And then this girl, too, both, you know, very nice. Like, you guys need help? I'm like, yeah. So he takes Tommy, throws him on his back, and this guy's all sweaty. So Tommy's, like, stuck to him, and he's running, like, starts taking off, running down the mountain. Like, this dude just got hurt. You're going to end up falling and breaking your ankles or something. So, but we did make it back to the car safely. And also, as the guy was running, he stopped and was like, "My calves are burning! Oh!" And it's like, as if he was, you know, he's trying, I guess, for a marathon, he said he's getting ready for. But I still think it was that they were angels Rossi sent to help Tommy. And, because that was the and the thing that's crazy is the guy ran with him for, like, about 2 miles, almost. Oh, but yeah, 3 miles. I was like, I don't know how he...
I weigh 165 pounds.
And then we made it to the car safely, and everything was good. But, so I want to leave you with this quote. I'm sure many of you already have heard, but it's worth repeating. Marriage is not about finding the person you can live with. It's about finding the person you can't live without. Aww. I believe my good friend and brother, Tommy, has found that person. Now everyone, please raise your glass. I guess maybe just put your hands. Raise your hands. May God bless Tommy and Grace in this new journey together as husband and wife. I wish them the very best and a happy and blessed life. Cheers. Amen.
Father and Son, the Holy Spirit, Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come together. We ask you to bless always the marriage of Grace and Tommy. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit down upon us tonight to keep everybody safe. Give us the strength and grace we need to fulfill our vocations and become the men and the women you created us to be young. Let's pray together. Bless us, O Lord.
These ideas which you are about to receive, and I am going to be Christ our Lord.
Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.